to see the devastating effects of the psychological sequelae of war is one of the best cases against war you could imagine. The devastating effect on young men's lives, on young women's lives, being in combat and not only seeing the destruction and the death and the devastation, but also the types of things that people do when they're in combat, things they would never do in peacetime, and that they have to live with in their conscience for the rest of their lives. The brain is a social organ, and when you're in combat, you're really going against some fundamental instinct that we have to, in a sense, protect and preserve not only ourselves, but other people. So I think combat is devastating, and we're going to be paying psychologically the price of this war for generations, because it just isn't the soldiers, it's their children and their grandchildren. I work with many children of Holocaust survivors, and it's as if they were in the war. Their biochemistry mirrors their parents' biochemistry, and their parents' terror and suffering and depression affects every part of their lives. The experience, not only in childhood, but also in combat, changes the shape and the nature and the functioning of the brain. And that brain then interconnects with other brains when people return from combat and, in a sense, traumatizes all the people around them. And a lot of combat vets and Holocaust survivors have an intuitive understanding about that, and that's why they tend not to talk about it to other people. I think it's very difficult for people to talk about these experiences because it activates so much pain. Simultaneously, people see the pain in other people's eyes when they're telling the story. And so in a sense, they have to then try to protect the people around them from their own experiences, which is why it's so important, to whatever degree they can, get help for anyone returning from combat to, you know, get involved in treatment.